1:30 PM Radnovich. We call to order the meeting, weekly Commissioners Finance meeting. And open the floor for any public comment. Go online. Okay, that moves us to the minutes in hand for the March 22 meeting.
Yeah, move to approve the minutes of March 22nd.
A second.
Okay, it's moved and seconded. All in favor to keep by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay, moves us to item four, the topics of discussion for today, which there are several. So we'll start, Carolyn's here. We'll start with the library system quarterly.
Thank you. I'm going to put this up here so I don't have to get up and down. You are welcome to, while I talk, open this and browse through if you'd like. One of the projects that I'm talking about. So you should have a PDF handout that gives, oh, look, it's right there on the screen. Thank you. So this outlines our projects. There's two pages to it. And so the green box, just a reminder of the five projects that we agreed to. And the bullet points in the yellow boxes tell you, you know, where we are with each one. And it's the first quarter, so we're still in the organizing phase of all of these, really. But things are moving along really quickly with the virtual reference program. We're on board. We've just been finishing up document. I don't think that's on there, that we've been finishing up documents with facts about Cumberland County and information so that even when our librarians aren't staffing the service, other librarians who staff the service around the state and the nation can help provide answers to Cumberland County residents. So that one's moving along very well. Our website usability went a little bit more slowly in that we are looking at consultants. We're gathering resumes and information about consultants to use for that project. It is, you know, getting there. The auto renewal is a pretty exciting project for us. We're really anticipating a good response to it, but we want to take it very methodically, make sure we understand everything about how the software works before we even attempt to turn it on. So we have a team of people led by our information technology coordinator who are getting that together. And at this point, we don't have a planned rollout date for that, but I'm hoping that by this summer, we'll be able to release that feature in some way. We're trying to see if we can do it to a small audience or if it's turned on for everybody, it's just turned on. The meeting rooms is another one that's gone a little more slowly than we've anticipated. We're building a team of people from each library to work on this. Meanwhile, my information technology staff are looking at software, and the software package we were really hoping would work is one we already own something from that company, and it would work right along seamlessly with it, except it doesn't work seamlessly is what we found out. So we're back to the drawing board to find other companies for room booking software and program registration software. I'm at least happy we have that answer. And then the last one is the backpacks, and that's the example I brought today. This is just one of, I think, seven backpacks that we created. I shouldn't say we don't take full responsibility. This is Bosler Library's team put these together as a sample, but it's a working sample. They're actually releasing these to the public, but it gave us an opportunity to learn how to catalog these, how to write a good, it's original cataloging, so it needs just the right MARC record, setting the circulation rules and things like that, and just, you know, what does this look like? And so so I brought that along for you to peruse through if you'd like to pass it down for everybody to see. But it's got inside, I believe there's a pair of binoculars in the front, there's a clipboard, there's a book, a notebook with activities and a book to read in there. So this is the vein in which we're traveling to do these, but they'll be putting them together around all kinds of different subjects. So there, thank you, Gary, for showing off the notebook with the book and activities. Yeah, so they did a really nice job. And like I said, it gave our catalogers a chance to figure out how they would do this on a bigger scale Because we're anticipating this will be something more like 35 to 40 backpacks and then continuously supplying them with the items inside. That's really my whole update, but I'm sure you have questions.
That's great. I really appreciate the fact that we're not just looking at footprints, but we're identifying a scat as well. Yeah.
Carolyn, I have to ask, did John Bittner have any input on the bugs and slugs version?
Not at this point. I don't think he has, but yeah, I actually talked about us collaborating with him to get like those tick, the tick identification cards with the tick removal tool and also the spotted lanternfly cards. And that was something I thought should go in every one of our backpacks. Because no matter what you're looking at, bugs, slugs, water, you're going to run into ticks and lanternflies for sure.
It's very good. I like that.
Thank you.
We're going to get one of these.
You need to get one of those. We'll see.
You're selling these, right?
No, these are to borrow. Borrow. Yeah, so that's why I said about the catalog or putting them. Got so you can look in our online catalog right now and find these and check them out. And then when they check them in, they make sure the major supplies are there and resupply as needed. So we're hoping we can put them in what's called a floating collection so that you can return it at any library and then it will just belong there. So we don't have to bother with the transporting them among libraries. So they won't all be labeled Bosler, but
right.
Bosler had their Cricut machine and decided to get very fancy.
This is very nice.
I was like, did you buy these tags? And I said, no, we made those on our Cricut. So, yeah. Any other questions?
No. Thanks, Carolyn.
Oh, thank you, Carolyn.
Right, well, we'll be back in June with another update. Okay. Between now and then, we're hoping that you'll be supporting National Library Week is coming up. April 23rd, I think, is the date. So I look forward to hopefully there'll be a proclamation and some support from the commissioner's office.
Past years, there was an event around that, you know, where the commissioners got updates and such. Is that reignited or I think it stopped during COVID?
Yeah, we've.
I know some of the individual libraries do.
We would come here usually to do a proclamation and a picture.
I must be thinking of the individual libraries.
Yeah, the libraries each do.
We would go a breakfast and a presentation.
Oh, you're thinking of the legislative breakfast.
Yes, like that was okay. It's been so long since
we haven't had one.
We had someone in Fredrickson and McCashburg and such. So.
Yeah. There are a couple of those coming up. I don't know if they're during National Library
Group. Okay. All right. So it's great. Okay. Great. Good stuff. Anything else for us?
That's everything I've got.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks, Carolyn.
New Randy Rainbow video on YouTube channel.
Oh, yeah? I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Okay. I thought that was our secret. Thank you very much.
Okay, very good. That moves us to our second discussion item today. That's status update on the deficit situation in regards to mental health. And Annie is up on the big screen, the jumbo truck.
Yeah, joining by Zoom here this afternoon. Well, thank you. What we're doing is we're working on analyzing some additional data. And I'm working on actually a couple of different scenarios, looking at how much services have increased since right at the time of the pandemic. And I'm hopeful that maybe next week we can come back with some scenarios to present to the commissioners. I think based on the analysis that I've done so far, honestly, I'm just very concerned about the impact across the county. I've talked to a couple of our other department heads and the concern is disastrous was the word that was used. So next week, I hope to be able to present, hypothesis around numbers and specifically around budget impact, but even greater than that, the human impact. And that's the part that I think I'm most concerned about. So I'm not really prepared to provide numbers here today because it was a bit more of a daunting project than what I was prepared to get into in a week. So I'm hopeful to be able to come back next week and provide some hypothesis around anticipated impact if we were to cut $2.5 million from our budget by the beginning of the fiscal year. We do have the public town hall meeting coming up Monday. So I'm pleased about the progress we're making with that and pleased with the number of individuals who are assisting with that, with the panel presentation. So that'll be Monday evening at the Lower Allen Township building. So we're advertising that and actually, you know, getting lots of positive feedback thus far about people who are planning to attend. So we'll be hearing from our community at that point.
And do you have any idea on when we might begin to get some indications out of the budget process? I know that's drawn out, but you know, there's hints that come out of the now and then, sometimes well in advance of a final decision, and sometimes pretty accurate. So do we have any concept?
Yeah, haven't heard anything yet other than the state is reviewing their current allocation structure. Actually, the past 2 days I've been with the Pennsylvania Association of County Administrators and meeting with them to have conversations about the budget as well as direction around the budget. And I think the feedback thus far has been very much the same, that counties are very concerned about the budget and is it enough to be able to sustain mental health services across the Commonwealth. Seems to be a steady theme at this point.
I was going to send you something that I saw in the paper the other day, and I guess I didn't get to it, but there was there were comments, questions asked in the paper of Scott Martin, who's the senator of Lancaster County now, used to be county commissioner. And I did not realize he's now the chair of the Appropriations Committee, so obviously a lot of budget questions for him. And he made the comment in response to that, that they are so early in the process that they have, you know, basically no concept until they begin their discussions, but that until leadership really comes to into the goes into the negotiations and such, there'll be no word on you know, what's being passed down to the rank and file members. So of course we're meeting with our delegation people and they're all essentially hand tied until they know what leadership's doing. So do we have, or has anybody suggested a method that more aims at getting the right people in front of, say, Senator Martin, who happens to be a South Central PA, you know, mid-state kind of guy, and we have through our caucus and other measures, you know, we know their commissioners, we know their county. It seems like the regional affinity there would provide an opportunity, perhaps, to, you know, at least put a case in front of him, granted just as one senator, but as one with a pretty hefty position. I can't imagine that Lancaster isn't also harmed by a lot of this. I don't remember the chart and what their, you know, their growing population. I don't remember the specific numbers, but they have to be hamstrung by this too.
I was actually with the Lancaster County, my counterpart from Lancaster County, for the last 2 days. And asked those very questions, and I haven't heard anything about the work that they're doing to meet with their delegation as yet. So I can certainly follow up again and see if there's any plans to meet with their delegation. And then maybe perhaps that regional approach may be a viable option.
Yeah, I don't know what the timing would be. That's why I asked the question, but I think that's needs to be on our radar. And the fact that we, you know, we do have a South Central Caucus of Commissioners that's often provided, you know, regional guidance. This is a heavy lift. So, you know, we want to make sure we're not overlooking any potential tools that are available to us.
I'll be happy to reach out, provide some feedback on that.
Thank you.
Sure.
Anything else for him? Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, that moves us back to a, we have discussion, ongoing discussion regarding the gun violence investigation and grant for a gun testing lab. So this was tabled at the last two meetings. So if we're going to move this into discussion again, we need a motion to untable this.
I will move to take discussion and approval of the gun violence investigation and prosecution grant award and contract for the district attorney's office FID off the table.
I'll have a second.
Okay, let's move to the second. All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Okay, that brings us to the actual discussion once again on the issue at hand, which is the investigation and prosecution grant award and the contract for the district attorney's office. And we do have the DA here, Mr. McCormack, as well as Eric on.
Eric's on.
Generally, any answers?
There were, when we were last discussing it, some requests for some projections as to what we might see over a five-year period. I went and checked with a couple different sources. One, Reading, Berks County has a firearm section. So we went and looked at the volume of cases they have, went and looked at the number of firearms that really a firearms expert could look at in a given year. Realistically, and that number tends to be about 100 weapons for an expert doing a variety of different things, some of them being shorter, for example, an operability, which is just making sure that the handgun works or the firearm works, that might take upwards of 3 hours. Part of that that time frame is the writing of the report as well as the examination, because all of these things typically require a report to be written. Some other things, such as a full examination, we're talking about measuring distances that a firearm may have been, and just the whole kit and caboodle, that could take upwards of 3 months by the time a report is finished. So there's a variety of different factors that come into the number of handguns and firearms that a person could examine. So we looked at that. We've looked at the number of firearms here that we potentially have in Cumberland County, and kind of came up with a projection of in year one. Year one is, and you should have hopefully the chart. In year one, essentially what we're talking about is the capital expenses, which are completely covered by the grant for the building and the equipping of the lab. Year two would be, we're estimating about 75 firearms coming through the laboratory. In looking at how Berks County, how things fell out, because they have a breakdown as to the type of exams that they do, I'm estimating about 45 of those being the quicker operability type examinations. About 28 being the comparison, which is kind of a middle range amount of time it takes to do one of those. And then a full analysis. The full analysis is typically something that we're doing in homicide cases. And so I anticipate potentially in that year two, the first year that we're doing exams, maybe doing two. If I recall, we have two firearms in for full reconstruction right now in New Jersey. So some of that is based on that. So then what I did was I took the what we're being charged, and that would be a good starting point as to what we would charge, and it came up with potential billables. What potentially could we be billing for this amount of firearms? And in year two, about $144,000. Now, obviously, a lot of this is going to be contingent upon collections. If we're making it as part of cost of prosecution. And as I progress through the different years and put the progressions, I kind of see us getting up around year four of this process of being able to be a maximum capacity. And that being 100 firearms. I think anything above 100 firearms, then what you're looking at is the potential that you would have to increase the number of people working. So, you know, 100 is kind of our limit. When you get to that point, I anticipate us having the ability at that point in time to not only be doing our own firearms, but also being in the process of being able to take firearms from other counties, other agencies outside of Cumberland County. When we get to that point, we have an opportunity at a much more stable billables, in that we're actually talking about agencies, just like we are paying in New Jersey, paying our bills. We're talking about an agency paying us. They can try to collect that money then from their defendants and their counties, but they would not be waiting. We would not be waiting for that money. That's kind of the projections that I've put forth here. I gave you also an idea of how much we have spent over the past year. Just the district attorney's office, a total of $32,341.45 for all the firearms that we had processed by a private lab over the past year. That took into consideration, in addition to the actual prices for the examinations, took in the tolls, the mileage costs, the personnel costs of taking two employees out of the lab for basically a full day. Now, although we took 11 firearms, we didn't make 11 trips. And what we try to do is economize when we're going down with weapons, we're also trying to pick up weapons at the same time. So it was 5 trips. We did have an expert testify one time last year. That was in the homicide case I had. We actually had scheduled that same expert to testify this week, but that case wound up being continued. I anticipate that person will be testifying again in May. There was also, at least it seemed to me, some question as to whether we were going to have the business, whether we were going to have enough firearms to keep these people busy. The one thing that in just talking with Eric and his staff at the lab, we were talking about how the firearms get packaged by the different police departments. And I asked them to find out for me from the beginning of the year, because the packaging that the police departments use come from our lab. We are the ones who have those boxes, those evidence boxes. And from January 1st through today, we have already given out 76 of these firearms boxes to the various police departments. Just yesterday, East Pennsboro picked up 6 of those boxes. So the volume of firearms that are being seized by the police are definitely there. One thing that, depending upon how we do as we roll this out, because there's other factors that come into play. We did look to see what other labs are out there. And there is a lab out there that is we actually use for some of our DNA stuff. When we do DNA testing here in Cumberland County, when we have the results, we do not have the ability legally to upload that into CODIS, which is the national database. You want to be able to get uploaded into CODIS so that the DNA is then nationally analyzed as to against any other DNA that's been collected. We what we do is we use the services of the Richland County Sheriff's Department. We can't use the Pennsylvania State Police because they refuse to do it for us. So we use the Richland County Sheriff's Department in Columbia, South Carolina to upload that for us. They have a vast number of services that they do in addition to the DNA. And one of the things I noted that they do is they do firearms examinations. And they advertise as to the amount per hour that they charge to do firearms exams for other counties and other states. I think if we do it the right way, we can get to that point. The one thing that, there's two things actually that make me a little nervous in saying that. One is I always want Cumberland County's weapons to get the priority. That's the reason why we're seeking this grant, is I want us to not be behind the long line of firearms that are being examined. So it's months and months and months. The second thing that makes me a little nervous, if we were to go as far as, you know, being like a going into other states and soliciting business from other states, would be taking our people out as expert witnesses to their courts and taking them out of our lab, which would have to find that balance. But I think we have the potential to mitigate the amount of money that the county is putting out after we get the lab set up and after we get the lab running. The lab is unique. The employees at the lab are unique among the different employees we have countywide, because it's the lab employees. I really can't think of many other ones in the county that have the ability for us to recoup money that we are putting out, paying them. And we do that already through some of the court costs and those sorts of things. We also have the contract with the Department of Corrections that we use, which supports at least two of our employees there. So I think when we look at the finances, which I think is your biggest concern, I think we have the ability to get a lab built, which is not a small thing, a lab built without the county putting any money out. We have the ability to get set up and equip that lab and to have two employees in place. The one thing I haven't spoken about, and I really honestly need to do a little bit more research into it, when I was looking at Berks County last year entered into NIBIN, and that's shell casing, 501 shell casings they entered into NIBIN. When I was looking at the South Carolina Sheriff's Department down there, they actually do NIBIN entries for $150 an hour. So, you know, that even the NIBIN potentially could be something that we wind up charging other agencies or charging as part of costs of prosecution. I didn't factor that into any of the figures that I put in that related billables. So I've tried to gather as much information as I can, give you what projections I think I can make at this point in time. I hope that you find the value in this grant.
How many homicides do we typically have? I'd
say five. You know, it varies from year to year, luckily. Last year we had, if we're counting homicides as people killed without getting into whether it's self-defense or not self-defense, we had about five last year. We had at least two instances where it looks like it may be self-defense, but those are still investigated as homicides. They're not just, oh, it's self-defense, so we don't do anything with it. And as I mentioned a number of times, even the suicides, we really need to take a very close look at, because it's not unusual for us to discover that a suicide is really a homicide. And until you do that full, thorough investigation, you're really not doing your job properly to reach the conclusion whether it's a suicide or a homicide.
Colin, we have an email here that you sent us with the 2022 firearm analysis data cost. It's a little over 32,000. Where are these guns coming from? Local police force?
Local departments. Different departments have brought them to us. Some of them were from some of the shootings that have occurred. I know for a fact at least one of the firearms that's going through full reconstruction is from the December 24th homicide in Hamden Township. That one, and talking about the amount of time it takes, that one is almost finished, and we brought that firearm to them like the last week of December, first week of January. So it takes about 3 months to do that type of exam. And then we haven't received that report yet, but I expect that report soon.
Why would then a local police force send the gun to us versus?
Well, because we're already looking at the gun for fingerprints, and we're already looking at the gun for DNA. And sometimes there's blood spatter on it. So we have that analysis too. So again, and this is going back 3 weeks now, but one of the things I mentioned is this is kind of a one-stop shop. Not only can we do the things that we are already normally doing, but we're also enhancing our abilities to take it the last final step.
Okay, so that 32,000 be eliminated from
yes
your cost, should be the county's cost.
Yes.
On this chart, which I find very helpful, year two, you have no salary cost. I thought it covered salaries for like 14 months or maybe
14 months. So I think, and this is where I might need Eric's assistance, but the last 2 months of this year, you said it's, yeah, just jump in, Eric.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Good afternoon, commissioners. It's the grant covers five quarters, four quarters in 2024, and the last quarter of 2023. Is what I covered for salary about it.
Yeah. I remember now.
So the idea would be
so I'm correct higher with year two being zero salary cost output by the county, correct?
Correct.
Yeah, because I remember now you had said this won't even get into operation till the end of this year. There's your okay. Now let's look at year two and the potential billables, and correct me if I'm wrong, Sean, you said we would not be charging Cumberland County agencies.
No, because I want to encourage our police right departments to give us these weapons to test.
So are all these numbers like 75 for year two from outside the county?
The 75 would be for inside the county. I anticipate there might be a handful from outside, but would be mostly from inside the county. There's two things I want to target. I want to target certainly any weapons that are used in any violent acts, but I also want to target those weapons I've been discussing. That really concerns me, the weapons that we are taking in, putting in evidence lockers, and they sit there and they are never tested. They could have been used in a homicide somewhere. They could have been used in another crime somewhere, and we're never testing it. And the more I've thought about it, like we had a situation a number of years ago, not that many years ago, with rape kits. Where rape kits were being done at the hospitals, the police were taking them and they were going on their shelves and they weren't getting DNA tested. I think we have to treat the firearms the same way. We have the firearm, we need to examine it. The potential billables there that I have, although it is for county firearms that we're looking at and we're not charging the actual departments, would be the cost that we would assign to the defendants upon being convicted as the cost of prosecution. And that's where I was getting into. You know, there's a certain percentage that, and whether we actually pull that money in year two, or whether that money is spread across year three and year four and potentially year five, the way it is right now with any of the costs that we're assigning to defendants, you know, it's not all necessarily collected in the year that we do the testing.
So that $144,000, realistically, how much of that will we collect?
Well, as Eric and I were looking at it, our collection rate, I think, is anywhere from the high 40s to the low 50. So if we're collecting about 50% of that, that is kind of what I'm looking at.
So that's the percentage you use to extrapolate this up.
It's not the number that's on the page, but if you were to divide that number by two, is the number I would think, kind of anticipate we would be able to collect. And some of them might be, again, over time.
So if that number is approximately 72,000, if you wanted to look at the full amount, you would want to add 32 to that 72, correct?
Correct.
Because that's the amount you're saving right off the top.
And again, I can go back and give you some of the figures for, you know, what we are pulling in from some of the other services that we provide from the lab. Last year, the court costs, we $263,988 is what we were actually able to collect. Back in 2019, when I'm looking at some of the total revenue, we're almost $382,000. So the lab does recoup. Again, I don't think we're ever going to get to 100% recouping the costs of the personnel, but I think when we look at the numbers, we do have to take into consideration, we need to take into consideration the fact that there will be some recoupment by the county of the salaries.
So those numbers you said, are they, is that the collections? Is that the total of collections, or is that unrelated collections? Or?
Finance put this together for me, so.
All right,
It listed here, it says total costs, total court costs, fees, charges.
Okay.
There's other monies we get. Now, when you look at the lab again, last year we also got $214,740 as part of the contract that we have with the Department of Corrections. So that's in addition to what we normally do. And a lot of these are DUI cases where we're testing the blood.
And how long is what's the term of that contract with corrections?
Eric, you know the term of that contract?
I'm sorry, it's 5 years.
Expiring. So, I mean, are we confident that revenue source is going to remain in place?
For three more years.
Three more years. Okay. All right.
And then, Sean, just to ask a question, by the time you get to year four, there would be a steadier sort of money coming in because you would be charging any other counties up front.
That's my hope.
Yeah.
That's my hope. And that's you know, what I'm.
So, how much of that total is based on outside?
I didn't break down as to how many. I think, you know, part of it is until we build it, I won't know exactly.
Sure. Yeah, we understand that. So,
and don't forget, you know, it's an unknown, so it's certainly something we can't rely on at this point in time. But we are hoping that ATF is going to supplement either some of the NIBIN technicians' salary. They actually contract and pay the NIBIN analyst down in Berks County. We're hoping to come to a similar arrangement. We don't have that arrangement, so it's not something I factored in here. But it is a potential and something we definitely are going to pursue.
Sean, you said something very interesting about CODIS, and we have to send that to an out-of-state sheriff's department. How much does that cost?
Actually, I do have that.
How much is it
costing
us for that?
I have that. So upload into CODIS, $350 an item. If it's a rush job, it's $740 an item.
And that's the DNA base.
Yes.
Yes, which is very important.
Yes.
Yes.
They do a lot of the things that our lab does. They do the APHIS, which is the fingerprints. They do blood stain pattern analysis. We have that in-house. Crime scene processing, we do that in-house. Latent print examination, latent print processing, the DNA, drug analysis, THC quantitation, which is the marijuana. Those are all services that we already provide our citizens here in Cumberland County and do a damn good job doing it.
I just remember being on the tour of the lab and one of the staff was showing me, it was a handprint analysis, and it was the case of an elderly person, right? Who the claim was that person had fallen in a pool and drowned, but the analysis revealed that that person had been pushed in the pool. That was a homicide.
Yeah, I mean it's amazing, and I've said this before. You know, when I was across the river, I knew there was a lab here. I was jealous of the lab here, but until I got here, I really saw what the capabilities are, how well run our lab is. The people there are top notch, and they're enthusiastic about what they do.
In this case of the individual being pushed, did that lead to a conviction?
I don't even, do you know, Eric? Of the equipment.
It's still working.
So now this, this facility in Berks, mm-hmm. which I don't think we were told about before, are they county only or are they a regional facility? How do they operate?
The numbers I have from them,
They're county lab.
It's county.
So they're just county. How long have they been around?
Commissioner, I want to say 3 years, maybe 4 years. That's close. I'm not 100% sure. I would say 4 years to be cautious, but no more than that.
Okay, that's fine. Do they have any plans to open up for outside or?
They do. They do the same idea that we have. They do exigent work for other, you know, counties around them if it's a push. But they basically do their own work in Berks County. There's a couple of counties that have a lab of some sort. Lehigh County, Montgomery County, Berks County, all have a firearms lab of some sort. They typically do their own work. And again, they'll do exigent circumstance work for those around them. But they don't, to my knowledge, they don't have any plans on doing anything regionally. I know that my understanding is Berks took their GVIP money. They bought a firing range, a portable trailer firing range to add distance determination to their capabilities that they did not have. And they also hired another part-time examiner. They were already at 100, roughly 100 cases. So I believe they hired a part-time examiner. I don't remember if it's a full-time examiner. I don't recall.
That's fine. I don't expect all the details. I'm trying to get a fix on the circumstances surrounding that. So, you know, Berks County has the city of Reading, which is, to my recollection, has a very high crime rate and has historically. So, you know, it makes a certain amount of sense there, but it begs the question then, here we have Lancaster County, Dauphin County, York County, which are So their rates are not quite as high, but they've got high rates and some of them are climbing. Mm-hmm. So why are they not doing this?
Well, I don't think they have the foundation. I think one of the things that we have that put us at an advantage in this grant process is we have the foundation with a lab already in place. We're looking to add on to a very successful and proven commodity where they would be starting from the ground,
sure,
the ground up. I think having the city of Harrisburg and the city of York in particular so close to us, and you may have just seen on the news, my counterpart, Fran Chardo over in Dauphin County, talking about the rising crime rate and shootings that they're having over there. They certainly have the firearms crime that you're seeing down in Reading, too. I think that's our potential market. I think that's our potential market
for
processing their firearms.
Okay. When we get to that point.
When we get to that point.
That's helpful.
That was a question. So if I'm looking at this, going back to the numbers, Sean, year three, we take the potential billables and apply what we usually recover out of that and reduce. I've also reduced the cost by $32,000 since we won't be dealing with New Jersey. Looks like year three, four, and five, we're going to be running a shortfall somewhere between $40,000 and $45,000 per year. But by then, we should be able to possibly bring in some, I'll call it work, from other counties.
Yes.
Okay.
As you mentioned, too, our labor costs may be higher. We may be looking to add at that point. Did I hear that correctly?
Well, what I said was, I mean, it's like anything else we do. We've got to make the decision. You know, if we get to the point and we're marketing ourselves well, and do we want to bring more people in, or do we want to say, hey, this is the size we want to be?
Right.
And this, so that's certainly a future question.
And you also said, Sean, that 100 firearms is probably
about the max
doable for two people.
Yeah, for it's really one person. One person does the firearms work. The other person does the NIBIN, and it's the firearms examiner of the two employees that is classified as the higher level.
We have a sense, since we were looking at Burks, you know, one of the things we're talking about here is we want to test all these to see if they match up to some other crime we didn't know about, if they lead to additional convictions. Do we have any idea on what their track record is?
I didn't ask.
We didn't ask. Okay.
I do know, I mean, the one, you know, historical story that I have is the one from Carlisle as to when they were able to get some of their shell casings uploaded into NIBIN. That's yeah. What helped them track down the murder weapon for a murder that took place in Carlisle.
Yeah.
And that's just, and you know, I was at a meeting, ATF did a presentation. It's where I first heard about what NIBIN was, because I didn't even know what it was at the time. And this was about a year and a half ago. And, when they started talking about NIBIN, it was like, you know, this is something that is there. It's something that's underutilized right now. And it's something ATF is really trying to get counties to get involved with so that we can build that database and be able to solve these crimes. And that's why I believe that we will get ATF support one way or another if we're able to get NIBIN into our labs.
So why isn't ATF offering financial incentives to get counties into this?
They were, weren't they?
Yes, they're, I don't know how they operate. I'm not really 100% sure. They seem to, they offer it to the U.S. Attorney's Office and through ATF, and then it dries up, it goes back and forth, and they're frustrating, a little frustrating to work with, because they won't talk to you seriously until you actually have the place built and in place and they come look at it. And then they'll start talking to you about contracts and things to do. Right now it's all in the talking stage, but they are supportive and they need the dive in entry desperately. So I think we're in a good spot to work with them once we open.
I think the ones that were available wind up being Philadelphia. That's where it winds up being placed.
Well, I don't sound flippant, but I mean, support that's verbal is cheap. Money, cash on the barrel, yep, head, yep. Seriousness. So we're not
saying. And again, I just throw that out as a potential that we are chasing. It's right. Not anything I factored into what I've presented.
It's not reliable enough. So I guess that's the question I'm getting at is, as I mentioned to you, my concern on this really is the timing of it and whether we've got far enough along that due diligence path to make that kind of commitment, given all the other challenges and demands that are going on right now. So what I'm trying to figure out is if there's such an urgency on this, shouldn't there logically be more than just this one grant opportunity if we decided to take a pass for a year or two?
Well, this is ARPA money. So right. It's, I think this is the opportunity to get this. I don't believe that this $1.5 million is for this purpose is going to be sitting out there again.
Right.
At least I don't see it in the foreseeable future. That would, I think, be an extremely big risk if we were to try to push it off. And again, when we look at what we're actually putting out, it's when we get to year three, that isn't going to solve the problem that you have this year, in particular with the mental health crisis that you're facing.
That crisis is still going to be with us.
It will.
Good.
And I anticipate we're still going to have crime.
I think so. Yeah. Sean, just to try to boil this down some so the commissioners really understand what you're asking them. From what I've heard you say, it sounds like starting in year three, that it would be anywhere from $0 to roughly $50,000 that you're asking the commissioners to kind of promise from the general fund. But that starting that year, there might be residual from the cases that are in year two and year three and year four, that the payment back from those defendants will continue to grow. And so you would expect potentially that number to maybe shift downward to maybe $0 to $40,000 as you move forward in time, as more money is owed by defendants for the cost of prosecution. Am I summarizing what I've heard you say correctly?
I would say that's a good summary.
Okay.
It seems like a long-term, very good move, and a cost savings to the taxpayer. And I mean, we've already we already have the money. We're just sitting around waiting to accept it. It seems like a shame to send it back, and then 3 years from now, be like, oh, we need to build this lab, and then the $1.5 million, and it will be more at that point in time. Would have to come out of the general fund. And what happens when you start sending money back? What does that do to our reputation, to our potential for future grant opportunities? It seems like a very bad move to me.
Depends on the grant.
But Sean, what do you
think? Well, it's PCCD. I would imagine a substantial number of the grants we get are from PCCD. And I know at least a lot of the law enforcement ones, that's where the money comes through. So, and this was, of all of the counties getting money, one of the largest grants that they approved outside of Philadelphia, which got, a substantial amount of money. But we, and I think it's a credit to what we already have, what we have done with the money that PCCD has already given us in the past, and how successful we have demonstrated our abilities to take their money and really put out a good quality product. I think it's a compliment to us and this county, our track record, that PCCD trusts us with this money to be able to do this with us. I would imagine that Well, I'll leave it at that.
Based on the information you presented, and even though not all our questions are answered, I certainly understand the case not to accept the grant. I really do. But I think we're at a point where, based on, you know, I hate to sound philosophical, but the way our world and society is going, our crime rate's probably, everybody's crime rate is probably going to continue to go. And looking at the salary costs versus what I think, and this is certainly, you know, we're taking a chance on this, but I feel, me personally, I feel much better with what you've stated today and what you presented, that I will present, or I will support the acceptance of this grant so this can get going.
Is helpful. I wish we'd had this earlier.
And I apologize. This is still a learning process for me. I hope in the future to
For
be
us
more in front of it than I was on this one.
I still have a lot of concerns regarding the timing. And there's a fair amount of this that's speculative. I mean, sometimes we have to go there to kind of understand. I'm not comfortable doing that this time. So, you know, this is, I'm very proud of your lab. I mean, the commissioners have put a lot of money into that. So it is a cutting edge facility, and I've been very supportive, I think, of everything that's come before us on that. This makes me nervous, and that's not a reflection on you. It's just, we're so early in the process. There's so many unknowns, and we do know some of the other challenges in front of us. And if we take a long-term perspective on those beyond, you know, a single budget year, and some other factors that, you know, haven't been discussed yet, I'm not sure I can do this right now. I my gut tells me, and granted it's speculation too, that if there's really this demand for this, that there will be more grants. There's always more grants. And I just don't think I can go along with this. I'm sorry. It sounds like you got your votes anyhow. So, but I'm not going to just go along with this. I mentioned before, some of this is, I'm jaded by past experience with counties saddled long-term grants. And once you have it, nobody's willing to get rid of stuff. Frankly, the lab was sold to us to some degree as something that was going to generate a lot of, you know, potential revenue. We've used that word potential an awful lot here today. And I use it myself to be careful and exceedingly as accurate as possible. But it doesn't allay my concerns. I can't help but mention it also, you know, the previous board approved a very bad proposal to add rehab down at Claremont with insufficient evidence on the hope and belief that it was going to save Claremont, and it didn't. And, you know, maybe some more due diligence in advance would have told us that it wasn't going to, or it would have pointed us toward a solution. So, you know, there's the unknown unknowns, to use a phrase. And I think right now I'm not sure this saves us money. I'm not sure the need completely exists. If I knew that Berks, for instance, had a, you know, a high rate of hits on their testing, and that it led to an outcome, this would feel a lot less speculative to me. We are also not on the leading edge of crime. We're on the leading edge of growth, which is driving some of our crime. All aware of that. So I'm just not there yet. I'm sorry. I'm hoping, you know, in the future, that I'm hoping this is very successful if it goes forward. If it's not successful, I think I would very much like to revisit this again when we have a little more information. But right now, I'm just not there. So, sorry. Okay, so are there other questions, Sean?
I don't have any. This is
This is your third time in front of us and presented all the information I need. Thank you.
Okay, so it provides for discussion and possible approval. So what's the wishes of the board in terms of action?
I'm okay to move forward with it. I appreciate, Gary, your comments. I really do. But again, I'm looking at this will be more of a positive than a negative. And, you know, if time proves me wrong, then it does. But I would not jeopardize the county if I didn't believe in this. And that's the time looking at this favorably.
Okay. You're making a motion?
Yeah, I'll make a motion to approve the gun violence investigation and prosecution grant award and contract for the district attorney's office FID in the amount of $1.5
million. I second that motion.
Okay, so moved and seconded. Any additional questions? I imagine there's any more questions at this point. And thank you for doing your best to answer the questions. So we'll call the vote on it. All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I have to register reluctant no. My apologies. Okay, motion carries. All right, thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate the time you've given me to present this.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thanks, Eric. Well, okay, that moves us off of the topic of discussion and toward into item five, which is other business. So are there other things to come for the staff, anyone? Nothing? Okay, in that case, we'll accept the motion for adjournment.
Move to adjourn.
We stand adjourned then. Thank you. Set off. I can't see it.
Hunter, you turned everything off, right?
Yeah.
Thank you.